Good afternoon, and thank you for joining us for this discussion of exercise intolerance and the multiple benefits of the techniques developed by today's featured doc, Dr. Tod Olin. We have over 700 people joining us this afternoon, thanks to the generosity of InsMed, our program sponsor. My name is Mark Krause, and we are bringing these dialogues to you in the hopes that you will gain valuable knowledge and be able to understand why, after 122 years, National Jewish Health continues to be a world leader in saving lives and improving the health of countless folks from all over through our outstanding research and treatment. This has never been more evident than over the past year with our efforts to address the pandemic through our testing developments, our treatments, and the establishment of post-COVID clinics, the over 80 COVID-related basic and clinical research projects ongoing, including those with our Respiratory Institute partners of Mount Sinai in New York and Jefferson Health in Philadelphia, and the tens of thousands of vaccines we have delivered to date. We have done all this while continuing to provide the same quality of ongoing care to our non-COVID patients as well. One housekeeping item before we begin. Please feel free to submit any questions through the Q&A tab at the bottom of the screen, and we will do our best to try to make sure we get to your question in the time allowed. I'd like to now welcome Dr. Olin. As with many of our premier physician scientists, Dr. Olin has earned multiple medical-related degrees, holding both an MD and a master's degree in clinical sciences. Patients travel across the country for diagnosis and treatment of exercise-induced asthma, as well as a myriad of other heart and lung conditions that present themselves during physical exertion, and exercise-induced laryngeal obstruction, also known as vocal cord dysfunction, for which Dr. Tod Olin has pioneered treatment. We are grateful to have him with us today, and this short video can give you a good idea of the dramatic impact of Dr. Olin's work. Please watch.
My name is Lexi Began. I'm 16. I like running, especially coming downhill. It kind of makes me feel like I'm flying. My identity definitely was as a runner, until the pain started. In the races, I'd make it a mile or two before the pain would start with this tingling in my arms. It was a severe burning pain in my stomach. By the time I had to drop out, I was usually in tears. The doctors couldn't tell me what was going on. They had a few suggestions. We did a lot of testing. They had no idea, or the test results came back negative. There was one doctor who pretty much told me it was all in my head. You kind of start to believe it. It was a tough time. It's kind of hard to look back on considering I was like really depressed, and I didn't really want to keep on living, so. Yeah. My coach saw an article in the Daily Camera, and he sent us an email saying, "Do you think it could be this VCD thing?"
During VCD, or vocal cord dysfunction attacks, the vocal cords partially or totally close, causing terrifying shortness of breath. So when we brought Lexi in, we were trying to recreate what was happening in real life. When Lexi's throat was closing, it was tremendously difficult to breathe. And then downstream of that, as she started to breathe faster and faster, some of those other symptoms were popping up, like the chest pain.
It gets to the end and she is spent. And he looked ecstatic. And he said, "I think we're gonna be able to help your daughter. I'm confident. We walked out and she just turns and she's bawling. She's like, "Mom, I might have an answer. They might have the answer." And it was like somebody gave me my kid back, you know? She raced the open race, and she raced, I think it was 330 girls, and she took fifth. She hadn't even been able to finish a race, and now she took fifth. For our family, you have changed our lives, and you have given my daughter hope, and her smile has returned. And from the bottom of our heart, we sincerely thank you.
My hope kind of soared. maybe I could have that dream that I've always hoped for. National Jewish Health has got me back on track. I can't wait for the next season.
Welcome, Dr. Olin. You developed a unique program for people with breathing problems during exercise. I wonder if you'd start by sharing with us your focus area, how the program came to be, and how the culture of National Jewish Health was central to its development.
Thanks for the opportunity to be here and share some of what we've done. And I'm happy to get at those questions. And so just like a little bit on me, and I think you did a great job sort of explaining my background. I'm a pediatrician, but I work with both kids and adults. And my interest area is really the interface of exercise with health and disease. And within that, I've just been really lucky as it pertains to EILO, or exercise-induced laryngeal obstruction. Again, this condition that used to be called vocal cord dysfunction at the beginning of my career. Like just a little bit on the condition itself before we like really launch into what we've done for it. It's a condition that causes this really terrifying shortness of breath during high intensity exercise. And it's frequently, and I think as in Lexi's case and in the case of a lot of other patients, it's misdiagnosed as asthma, mostly because asthma is really common. And the two conditions share that feature of causing shortness of breath during exercise. But what happens during the attacks is that the throat's closing up. And I'm going to show you a video of sort of a typical prototype patient, just so you can get a sense of the type of shortness of breath that we see. And so you'll see this woman pop up on the screen. I just want you to pay attention to her breathing. So it's noisy, it's frightening. It comes on really quick sometimes. And I want you to pay attention. I'm gonna play the video one more time. I want you to pay attention to how quickly it goes away as well. And just so those of you that are watching really understand what's going on, again, the larynx or the throat is closing up right about here. And what you'll see in the next slide is a windpipe of a prototypical patient. And so there's cartilage around the top of the windpipe, all of this sitting in the back of one's throat. Air is going to pass in this triangle in all patients between these two white lines, the vocal cords. Now I'm gonna show you what happens during exercise, and what you'll see is 10 seconds of moderate exercise followed by 10 seconds of high intensity exercise. And I want you to notice the difference in the size of the triangle, the difference in the position of those two vocal folds between the two different segments of the video. So again, early exercise or moderate exercise and then high intensity exercise. Those vocal folds are much, much narrower they're much, much narrower late in exercise compared to early in exercise, and this is not normal. Most people, that triangle just stays the same size regardless of exercise intensity. And so our program for this condition really started kind of humbly. I think like a lot of doctors around the country, I think we suspect this in a fair number of patients, and I certainly did early in my career, and the challenge was we could just never prove it in a way that seemed helpful to patients. And one of the reasons for that is probably because the attacks, these episodes where the vocal cords narrow up, they go away really quick in some people. And the techniques that I was trained to use early in my career and the techniques that are still used today in most hospitals rely on looking with a camera down somebody's throat after they exercise after they jump off the treadmill, because it's just logistically a lot more feasible than what I'll explain in a minute. The challenge was that these attacks, we would just never see them. We could never prove that patients had them. And so our program really started around this moment where a few of the folks in the exercise lab and myself decided that, like, well, what if we could hook up this camera during exercise, like a group in Norway had proposed doing and had been doing for a few years prior. And everything really launched downstream from that. We were able to then diagnose quite a few more patients. I think we developed a little bit of a reputation for being able to do this. And what the procedure looks like is the following. And so the procedure itself is called continuous laryngoscopy during exercise. What's going on is we put a 3-millimeter camera down a patient's throat, through their nose actually, and we can see their throat in real time while simultaneously measuring just about everything else that happens during exercise with their heart, with their oxygen, with their breathing. And what it allows us to do is just get a really definitive diagnosis as to what's going on. And if something else is going on, that other information can be really helpful. So downstream of that, a lot of different things happened. More and more patients came, and we realized at a certain point that despite the fact that we could diagnose this with really high resolution, we didn't have as much success treating it. And so in about 2014, sort of the next big thing that happened in our program was that we believed the patients that said they weren't getting better despite what we were doing. And so what we did was we used that same procedure again, the continuous laryngoscopy during exercise, to really evaluate the mechanics of how these people were breathing. But we wondered if they weren't getting better because of that, or if there was something else going on. Like maybe they weren't conditioned to do these traditional breathing techniques, things such as breathing in through the nose or out through pursed lips. You know, maybe they just weren't able to do those at high intensity, or maybe there was something happening with their, you know, kind of in the behavioral health realm, something with their psychology, like perhaps an overlap between anxiety and the problem, or anxiety in their sport, leading to a lack of responsiveness to the techniques we were teaching. And then ultimately, we just wondered if some of the techniques simply wouldn't be possible to do during certain types of exercise. For example, like, it's not rocket science to wonder if, like, well, gosh, maybe you couldn't sniff in through your nose if you were swimming. And so what we did was we employed our sort of new diagnostic technique in sort of a new way to really understand therapy. And it led to a couple really amazing changes. The first being that we realized that all four of these areas were important in most, if not all, patients. And the second thing was really just a total stroke of luck, but it related to a patient that was trying some of the traditional breathing techniques while we were having her exercise with a camera down her throat. And she made this really ridiculous mistake with the technique, and it was really, really helpful. It opened her throat up in a way that we weren't expecting at all, you know, weren't planning for at all. And so in this one index patient in about 2014, someone that had had symptoms for about 3 years prior to coming to see us, we were able to just really make up a breathing technique on the fly with her sitting there on the bike, tried to teach it really, really quick. Again, just completely shooting from the hip on this one. And she came back 3 days later for a repeat session and was essentially cured. And it was really in that moment that we realized we were on to something. Now, these techniques have been, you know, manipulated and modified over and over again since 2014. But it was really that first patient that made us realize that we were on to something with a new way of breathing. And it's something that we now call the EILO breathing technique. And really what we do in our program now from the treatment perspective is we pair this now more of a therapeutic procedure that we call therapeutic laryngoscopy during exercise, using the camera as a teaching tool for this new breathing technique, again, the EILO technique. And so over a series of days, patients come in, they meet our team, which has grown quite a bit now since 2014, which includes respiratory types like myself, speech and language pathologists, and psychologists. Over a series of days, patients will come in, they'll learn these new ways of breathing, and then we kind of launch them back into the wild, and they're able to do these techniques in their sport of choice, be it you know, swimming or running or combat sports like MMA fighting. You know, at the end of the day, we just want people to be able to do what they want to do. This is not something that's just for high performance athletes, but it's gained quite a bit of notoriety, you know, in those fields as well. So super question. What we do now is over again, 5 days, we get all these different types of specialists together in a really collaborative way. And we help these patients. Now, where things have grown is in the numbers. So now hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of patients are coming every year. We have a new group of six starting every week. And so it's a really exciting program for us because we feel like we make a big difference in the lives of these patients. And if you guys are interested in hearing more about the program or a specific patient online, something that we'll do is we'll intermittently throw up QR codes, and you can pull out your phones from home, scan this QR code, and you'll be able to read another story about another patient other than Lexi, who, by the way, is running at the University of Hawaii these days. He's now a Division I runner and is still having success. Another thing I want to sort of mention to you guys is we're happy to be a resource. So if you have specific questions about what we do, please feel free to email me. We can't give, you know, specific medical advice for specific questions sometimes, but we're happy to be a resource if you have general questions about what we do here. What else are you curious about, Mark?
Can you speak to how your Exercise and Performance Breathing Center is attracting the attention and interest of sports-related organizations and others outside of National Jewish Health?
Yeah, so good question. So, what we've noticed is that there's a lot of things that have happened. So initially, as we developed this program, we started to get a little notoriety. And at the beginning of all of this, it was probably in about 2017 where things really upticked. And we were asked to, you know, be the editors for a specific journal about this and speak in Europe. And then we were able to work with the United States Soccer Organization around, you know, putting out some information around both asthma and EILO. And things really picked up from there. We were able to develop a relationship with the United States swim team and with the U.S. Olympic and Paralympic Committee. And we were able to help a large number of athletes, but we realized that the relationship was important for other reasons too. And this has been really obvious in the past year where these organizations that recognized our respiratory expertise were able to leverage that to help them with things like COVID. And so a whole new set of problems came up for the different organizations, specifically questions around how do we keep our athletes safe or how do we run our organization in ways that are compliant with all of the different public health codes, but are able to deliver the products that were central to these different groups. And so at the hospital, so at National Jewish Health, we've been able to launch a new COVID mitigation team for institutions. And so, for example, the University of Denver has been able to work with us quite a bit and get their classrooms open safely and really keep COVID at bay on that particular campus. More recently, sort of through the links in the sporting world, groups like Little League International have reached out to us to provide consulting around how to run things like the Little League World Series safely. And so it's really kind of fun that we're able to have an impact beyond the impact on any one particular patient or any small group of particular patients. And we hope that that continues in the future, maybe with things like different Olympic trials and things like that, because the challenges that the pandemic produces are really, really incredible and far beyond the skill set of like any one organization or really any one doctor. And so here, you know, we're able to leverage the input from, you know, occupational health experts and pulmonologists and infectious disease experts and lab experts and others that so that these groups can get a really encapsulated set of advice on how to operate their groups. But super question.
So finally, can you talk about like what's on the horizon for your work and some of the benefits you see that may emerge in both diagnostics and treatment going forward And ultimately, what'll it take to get there?
Yeah, so good question. So for us, 2021, there's a couple things going on. I mean, first, like we want to help the Olympics go through. Like I'm involved in that a little bit. We're really going to make an effort on the research side. So we're going to try to understand a lot more around what is causing EILO? What is behind this? And then secondly, like, why are certain people showing up and not everyone showing up? And so we've noticed, for example, that African-American patients very rarely are referred in, even locally. And we don't really understand why that is. And we don't really think there's a biologic reason for that. We think it's more of a social thing. And so we're going to do our best to leverage the input of psychologists and social scientists to really understand what's going on behind what appears to be a referral bias, because if we can understand it and fix it, we feel like we can help a broader audience and a more diverse audience in a good way. We're also going to really try to help a wider group of patients other than those with EILO. And so we're developing a new clinic. It's actually running now, where it's a collaboration between an adult pulmonologist and an adult cardiologist to understand all sorts of different problems that pop up during exercise. The key thing being that what we're hearing from patients is that the heart doctors and the lung doctors don't talk. More traditionally, they tend to blame each other for problems that they can't understand. And so the value that we're bringing to patients is you get both of those specialists in the same room at the same time talking about what's going on in a given patient. And then downstream, really what I bring to the equation is the ability to innovate new procedures, you know, measure new things that haven't been able to be attacked previously. And so hopefully we'll be able to develop new products around that and like a new level of innovation. And so that's one of the exciting things. And probably the last big thing is we're trying to develop clinics that use exercise as medicine, exercise as the therapy. And so for those with specific types of diseases, like interstitial lung diseases, for example, we would have a collaborative group, maybe a nutritionist, psychologist, physical therapist, in addition to the pulmonologist, coming up with a really collaborative way of using exercise as the medicine on top of the latest biologic, you know, medications and things like that, that will help the specific causes of the lung disease. And in terms of what it takes to get there, I think the biggest thing that we've learned is it's a team. Like we have to build the team. It's hard to, you know, do 1,000 procedures in a year and perform research and help outside organizations and educate the next generation of doctors as an individual or as a small group of people. Like it takes a lot of us to put that together and make all of those different facets move forward. It takes the help of, you know, your team to get the word out, you know, both on EILO, maybe, you know, changing the caricature of who has EILO. And then, you know, for things, specific things like the exercise as medicine, it'll probably take a little bit of philanthropic help because most, you know, insurance companies would never cover the services of a nutritionist or physical therapist and sometimes even a psychologist. And so it'll be this partnership between donors and us to really bring the newest things to these niche groups of patients. Super questions, though. Thanks.
I have a ton of questions from the audience I'd like to get to now.
Yeah.
In terms of coupled in the EILO is, how do you tell the difference between asthma and EILO? And can you elaborate on what exactly that breathing is, the EILO?
Yeah, super. So there's going to be overlap between exercise-induced asthma and EILO, certainly like in the sense that they'll both cause people to be out of breath. But there's a couple really distinguishing features. The first is that asthma, even though we really, really associate the word wheeze with asthma, it's really, really unusual for people to hear an asthmatic wheeze as it relates to exercise. And so, for example, in the Super Bowl, my guess is there were roughly 20 to 25 people that were on that field as players at one point in time or another with asthma, and you couldn't hear any of them wheezing. The announcers couldn't tell. Asthma is not a real visibly, audibly obvious condition. EILO, on the other hand, is really something that I can sit there on the sidelines of a field or on the pool deck and point people out with one finger because I can hear the breathing, that characteristic gasping breathing. It's a lot scarier too, in that patients with asthma, again, the Super Bowl announcers aren't picking them out. They're not panicking in association with the breathing. EILO is a lot more sort of viscerally uncomfortable. It's quite obvious that the patients are struggling. And the other probably big distinguishing factor between the two is the time course. So asthma takes 5, 6, 7 minutes to trigger. Again, the characteristic feature of asthma being a cough. And it really, like in the absence of therapy, will tend to persist for half an hour, maybe an hour. EILO comes on really just during high intensity, and it can go away quick. We've had athletes where the throat will open in as little as one breath after they stop exercising. And so it tends to be very short-lived after exercise has stopped. And so those are the big distinguishing features. It's the visible obviousness, it's the audible obviousness, it's the time course, and it's this sort of visceral link to fear that we see in the EILO patients we don't see otherwise. And then as far as what we're doing with the breathing, it's tricky. And I'll just tell you right now that like a 1 minute sort of overview is not going to do this justice. Just like watching a YouTube video of somebody doing a backflip on a snowboard is not going to teach you how to do this in the middle of a 200 butterfly, for example. But what we're doing is we change the resistance to air coming into the mouth every once in a while. So on, you know, initially as we're teaching this, on every fourth breath or so, we'll have patients intentionally block the air as it comes in. One way of doing this is sort of placing the lower lip against the top teeth. So as they're inhaling, they block the air, making a squeaky noise. And then in the same inhalation, they drop off the resistance, opening their mouth and letting the air rush in. So the whole thing looks something kind of like, and the throat does something to compensate for the resistance at the lip. And it opens up right at the moment that the resistance breaks. And so it's something that if you can learn to do and learn to control in the moment can really bring you a lot of relief during high intensity exercise. Good question.
Question is, are you using any medicines in the treatment of EILO in addition to different breathing techniques?
Yeah, so super question. So the times that we'll use medicine for sure are when we're trying to tackle things that we think might contribute. So it turns out a lot of people do have asthma, and that is treated best with medicine. And so we'll certainly use things like albuterol or control inhalers in those cases. If patients are allergic or are struggling with post-nasal drip and things like that, maybe stomach acid, we'll use medicines to treat those things. There is one or two papers out there suggesting that a medicine called Atrovent might be helpful. We have not particularly noticed that. There is a group in Norway that's actively studying this right now. The jury's still out on whether or not it actually helps. It's really safe. It's not Atrovent. It's like inhaled Benadryl. Doesn't hurt to try. It's often not covered by insurance, so there's sort of a financial deterrent there. We don't reflexively rely on it, but other centers do. I will say that I know that there are places that do. But generally speaking, when people come into our program, if there's nothing else going on without the EILO, they're actually walking out of here without any medicine.
A number of questions about specific diseases. So in general, do you believe that the techniques can be valuable for any of the other respiratory diseases that we treat?
Yeah, so that's a good question. So I'll be blunt in saying that we didn't design it for other diseases. Like we designed it for this one phenomenon where people's throats are closing up when they're exercising. Now we have heard anecdotally from other people that it can be helpful for other things. For example, there is a condition where people tend to chronically hyperventilate. And in a handful of these patients, they've said that the breathing techniques have been helpful. Now, is it because we're opening their throat or is it something else related to the overall process? Maybe just the control of breathing at a really conscious level? I'm not totally sure, but we've heard anecdotally that the techniques can be helpful. We've also been asked if this can help people just improve their performance overall because some people have written us and said that it has. Again, I don't know exactly why that would be, because their throats should be open. Although I think there's a lot to learning, like how to really, really manage the pace of breathing and the depth of breathing that probably do sort of center an athlete or maybe make their overall energy expenditure more efficient. That could be helpful. But again, like we designed this for the throat, and we're glad if it helps other people, but it wasn't the original intention for sure.
So what can you speak more about what's different or exceptional about what NJH does and what other organizations do or don't do?
Yeah, well, there's a couple, I think there's a lot of things. Like certainly at the highest level, like just what, like how did the institution make this happen? Because a lot of my mentors tell me like, you could have never done this anywhere else. And there were probably a lot of different parts to that. Like the first one that stands out is, I remember when I was interviewed for my first faculty position at a fellowship, the department chair at the time, you know, asked me what I wanted to do. And I said, well, something exercise. And I didn't really know what I was talking about. And he knew that I didn't really know what I was talking about. And he just said, hey, look, whatever you do, just find a disease, figure out what causes it and cure it. Like you're at the place to do that. That's what we're here for. And that really resonated at the time. And I just didn't hear that in any other interview. And there was certainly like along the way, this spirit of innovation, like the length of the leash that I was granted to develop these things is just different. Like I've been allowed to push the envelope knowing that I'm going to fail sometimes. And as long as we're doing that in a controlled way and learning from it and making the product better, there's freedom to do that here. And then I think the biggest thing in the past year is, with COVID, I mean, the procedures that we do are really, really high risk from the perspective of disease transmission. There are papers coming out of the best labs in Europe saying, don't do continuous laryngoscopy until further notice. And we've been able to leverage the history of the hospital, actually, as a tuberculosis facility, which, you know, kind of coincidentally or not, developed a lot of the airflow systems, the HVAC systems, such that we wouldn't be spreading tuberculosis from patient to patient in rooms, and we're pumping the air out to the street from the rooms. And then we've been able to use those rooms as our new exercise lab. So other labs around the country really haven't been able to open. So that I know we're the only place in the country right now doing continuous laryngoscopy during exercise. That might have changed in the past few months. You know, the other things that are really unique are that no one else is really doing therapeutic laryngoscopy during exercise, sort of using the camera as a teaching tool, like a window into the mind. And no one, there are other centers using our breathing technique now, the EILO technique. I don't really think it's fair to say that other centers are teaching it quite like us. I mean, there's nothing quite like standing next to the person that invented it and the speech therapists that have been sort of with it since its inception. And so the expertise around that is it's just going to be different. It's not to sort of undermine what other centers are doing, but the level of expertise is just orders of magnitude different, because we see just this year, we might see 800, 1,000 patients with this. Wow.
Can you speak to a psychological aspect and how it interfaces with EILO?
Yeah, that's a good question. So, you know, I was, you know, kind of sitting around a campfire, you know, on vacation with someone who was letting us stay at their house with an Airbnb. And they said, you know, what is it that they really do? What we really do with this camera. And she said, can you tell how people are feeling when you look at their throat? And the short answer is, yeah, I think I can. I can tell when people say they understand things and they don't. I can tell when people are frustrated just by looking at their throat. And so it is kind of interesting. It's sort of this window into the mind-body connection. But now what we do is we really have a whole curriculum around all of the common, really psychological, not maybe not all of the common, but the phenomena that we have detected in the exercise lab related to psychology that seem to affect the ability to control one's throat and the ability to control exercise. And maybe that's something as simple as managing distractions or bouncing back from little temporary setbacks, you know, like second to second, or maybe more you know, deeper things related to sources of motivation. You know, are people exercising because their parents want them to, or because they're trying to hold on to a scholarship, or because they really love exercise? Because the ways that you deal with those two different situations are quite different. You know, we deal with patients that are really self-critical, or, you know, are dealing with other phenomena that really get in their way. Like, when we look at what we do is we're trying to get the patient out of their own way, and we're using how we teach them to breathe as sort of the platform to teach them about their own psychology. And it's improved things just in a way that we would have never predicted back in 2014.
Are you seeing any post-COVID clientele? And if so, would you please speak to the desaturation post-exercise, which leads into then any just a general comments about any observations that you've seen over the past year with COVID?
Yeah, super question. I mean, so the first thing to say is, wow, this is all really, really new. And I will say that people are really interested in this. And there is certainly a bunch of people out there that seem to be well otherwise, with the exception of an inability to exercise to their previous level. And sort of speaking to colleagues around the world, I'm fortunate in that, like, I'm friends with the doctor that is the respiratory doc for the Team GB, you know, in the UK, their Olympic team, and the Norwegian Olympic respiratory specialist. And this is out there. We recognize it. There's probably different patterns to it also. There's some that are dealing with more of a chronic fatigue syndrome. There's some that are really just affected during exercise. There's other things as well. Clearly, if you had severe COVID, that's going to affect the blood vessels of the lung. That's going to affect the spongy tissues of the lung. It's going to make oxygen less able to diffuse into the bloodstream. I will say that there are certainly patients that we're still trying to figure out. Early on, we were really worried about the heart. There was a lot of data. It was cardiac MRI data coming out of the university. So Ohio State, there was a paper out of West Virginia, I believe, that really got at these inflammatory syndromes of the heart early on. I think more and more we're a little less worried about the heart, and we're starting to blame both the lungs more and something about maybe the brain's ability to control breathing, in that people feel out of breath, out of proportion to what we're measuring with machines. I think that's a thing in COVID, and we're still learning a lot about it. There's a lot of people out there that say they're out of breath, and the machines say you shouldn't be out of breath. And I believe them that they're really out of breath, but we've got to develop new technologies to get at the ability to control, you know, how is the brain controlling breathing? What's the brain detecting? And I do think COVID really got in that loop and is manipulating things in a tricky way.
Someone asked, at what age does this surface in kids, when might present itself, which then leads to, is there a cure? Do you outgrow it, or is it something that's managed throughout life?
Yeah, super. So it turns out when we're really getting out into the weeds, with this, there's different versions of EILO. And so there's the classic version where the vocal folds close up. But there are other versions where those pink structures around the vocal cords, the cartilage, might flop into the airway, where the entire structure kind of folds down. And then there's another version where it's as if the tissue covering the airway, like the skin, if you will, it's not really skin, but it sort of sucks into the airway like a sheet getting pulled down, not really into the lungs, but partially into the airway. It turns out that the prototype patients are teenagers. You know, sort of like Lexi in the video, like the 15-year-old. Maybe in that classic version, we're seeing patients, you know, 11, 12, 13 sometimes. It can, the other versions are showing up earlier. So when a patient shows up with what seems to be a convincing story for EILO, but they're 6 years old, it's probably one of these other variants, the type where the tissues are flopping down. In terms of growing out of it, we don't know. So there's certainly data out there that says that if you don't take care of it, it persists. There's data out of Sweden that suggests that. Now, it's not really ethical to study it in that way. Like, if I find out you have a problem, I'm not going to just sort of leave you there, you know, wondering what's going to happen for the next 10 years. I'm going to do my best to fix it. We've certainly had patients that have shown up in their 50s and 60s. You know, certainly a lot of patients in their 50s that say, gosh, I've had symptoms for 40 something years. You know, do you think it could be this? And we've been able to show that that's the case. I think our oldest patient is right around the age of 70 that we've taken care of and treated. So I don't really know exactly if everyone outgrows it. Now, there is certainly the phenomenon of, you know, will Lexi, in this case, the woman in the video, will she be running as hard as she is now as a Division I athlete in 5 years? I'd say, like, yeah, very few people do. It's just hard to be working out 4 hours a day, you know, 3-4 hours a day, you know, once you're not told by a coach to do that. And so that might affect the perception of outgrowing versus not, you know, but we're here to help kind of anyone regardless of age.
Is it safe to use preventive inhalers like Flovent long-term? Someone asks who uses a low dose every 5 days.
Yeah, so getting into like the specifics around medications gets a little tricky. Certainly in the case of Flovent, as a poison doc, you know, the toxicologist would say the poison's in the dose. Really low doses, really, really safe. You know, you're using, you know, something like Flovent 44 once a day even, you're not going to run into tons of side effects over the short term, certainly like once every 5 days. It would be almost impossible to measure anything. However, if you're using something like Flovent in high doses for prolonged period of times, you know, we will see things like growth suppression in kids. And over time, you get sort of the effect of steroids in adults, you know, effects maybe on bone density or sort of the clarity of, you know, the structures in the eye and things like that. The integrity of the skin might change a little bit. So you want to be, you know, careful with the how much. It's fine to, you know, under supervision of a doctor, try medications, but you just need to know what you're looking for, and you need to sort of know what you're measuring so that you can call a spade and know when to stop if there's not an effect.
So would this technique work for normal shortness of breath after exertion, like running upstairs?
Yeah, so that's a good question. So there's a couple things there. Like one is, you know, early on in the talk, I mentioned that EILO tends to happen during high intensity exercise. And so this is kind of important for people. If you're really struggling walking up a flight of stairs, it's probably not your vocal cords. And I know that even at our institution, even 10 years ago, we used to blame the vocal cords for that sort of presentation all the time. And it's only through doing these procedures more and more that, you know, and having the humility to say, yeah, I was wrong 5 years ago, to say, like, you know, it's probably something else. So it's sort of, I think the first part of that is, well, let's figure out what it is, because I'll tell you that it might not be the vocal cords. And it might be something more related to oxygen dropping off or something else related to the control of breathing. But there's several different breathing problems out there. If there's high blood pressure in the lungs, that will really limit people at low intensity exercise. And it's something that, you know, we'll want to figure out. And then, and certainly in our new, you know, joint cardiopulmonary exercise program that we would be looking for, among other things.
Can you share the multidisciplinary team? You spoke to the psychologist, but you also mentioned the speech therapist. And how does that play into it?
Right. So what we're doing, like at the end of the day in our program, what we're doing is we're leveraging everything that we can do, essentially just teach you a different way of breathing in a moment that you really, really care about. And so like the sort of the three cornerstones of it, there are the respiratory types like myself, and myself and my partner, Lizzie Fan, we're using the camera as the teaching tool. It's really just like a souped up teaching tool more than anything else, where patients are able to look at their throat and see it in real time. And we'll just know on the fly, like, wait, a little bit longer, a little bit shorter, a little bit stronger, a little bit weaker, so that we can get the throat to move the way that we want. Now, the speech therapists are taking what we're doing and then translating it a little bit more to real life. So now without the constraints of the helmet and the camera and the really rigid exercise protocols that we're using, they're taking kids to the swimming pool that we have on campus. They're taking kids, you know, to the basketball court, you know, prior to the pandemic. That's a little tricky now, but they're getting them in those real life situations to then find out what the constraints are of those activities, and then overlapping what we're teaching them and then integrating them in those real life situations without constraints. And then the psychologists, again, are getting at, there's really a couple things. One of the big things that we're going after is, how does this person learn? Because what we found, and this kind of makes sense, that like, do guys and girls learn the same way? Like, anyone that has teenagers in their house or that's had a boy and a girl come through the household will say, like, yeah, not really at all. And how does learning change across the age? Or is somebody from Manhattan going to learn the same way as somebody from Texas or Alabama or Michigan or, you know, the Midwest or California or another country? No. Like, I guarantee you, the Manhattan people do not laugh at the same jokes as the Alabama people. The people from other countries, they don't like any of my jokes. They're thinking I'm making fun of them. And so the psychologist is helping us unravel really the secrets to customized learning on top of going after the things that they see as barriers to doing what they want to do. It might have to do with sources of motivation or goal setting or bouncing back from setbacks or dealing with sort of that hypercritical self-talk and other things. And it's really those combinations of the respiratory types, myself being really, really constrained around the mechanics of breathing, the speech therapists that are really, really employing this in real life situations, and then the psychologists, and then we just all talk a lot. Because it's really common for the speech therapist to run into a psychology sort of barrier, or the psychologist to run into something that seems really biomechanical. And so if we're all talking, we can sort of act as a single voice, and it works really well in concert.
A tangential question, sort of a post-COVID population this woman treats are all post-COVID firefighters. They may desat to 70s post-exertion without the expected increase in heart rate. The autonomic service seems to be at play, and I wonder if you can just comment on the impact of the autonomic system.
No, that's a thing. COVID. I mean, I think really early on in the pandemic, you know, April 2020, there were papers coming out of patients walking into the emergency room wondering if they had COVID, a little bit out of breath, but not looking really impressive. We check their oxygen, 68, 72, very, very, very low. Numbers that you would, as a doctor, traditionally tie to really just extreme shortness of breath or just total panic. And it was really that disconnect between the low oxygen and the apparent wellness of the patient that threw people for a loop at the beginning. And it was one of the reasons I think that people really resorted to using ventilators early on in the course of this condition last spring. And I'm primarily a pediatrician, but I'll recognize that the ventilator management of COVID in the severe cases has really, really evolved in the past 10, 11 months. But now speaking to the firefighters that are coming in, I wonder a lot about a couple things. One is the ability for oxygen to diffuse from the lungs into the blood vessels, and then also for the brain to detect low oxygen. Because it seems as if these COVID patients are not responding to low oxygen in the way that other people respond to low oxygen, you know, in our traditional training. Like, you know, if somebody shows up in Denver, they've got interstitial lung disease. They got off the plane, their oxygen 78. They look really, really out of breath by the time they make it to the hospital. And COVID's a different beast. I agree with you. And we hope to uncover some of those secrets and maybe get after them and treat these patients in different ways moving forward.
Do you see much success with an aerobike or aerobica with this condition and others?
Yeah, so what aerobic is, for those that don't know, haven't heard of it, it's a device that it was designed for patients with diseases that were characterized by lots of mucus in the lungs, cystic fibrosis really being the model. And so we're in the air tubes of the lungs going down to the spongy part of the lung. If mucus piles up, it becomes hard to get air in, and it becomes hard to, you know, clear those secretions, especially if they're thicker. What aerobica does is it's something that patients blow into, and it generates a back pressure, sort of opening up the airway, and then it vibrates. And so it moves the secretions along in the airways where maybe like a cough isn't alone sufficient. It's not something that we've used in EILO. There is a different device that people have tried, and the group in Western Norway that's well known for their therapy in EILO uses another device called an inspiratory muscle trainer. And it's and so while the mechanics of it are not related to aerobica, what it is patients are inhaling really forcefully against a resistor, sort of like lifting weights for your respiratory muscles. And what they have anecdotally shown is that it does seem to make some patients feel better. Now, studying it in a really systematic way does not seem to have made a really huge impact yet, but it's not a dangerous thing to try. All I would say about both of them is, you know, it takes time to work with both of these, and if time's something you value and it doesn't seem to be doing much, I wouldn't spend a lot of time on it, but it's certainly safe to, you know, if you want to try it once or twice, sure, see what happens, but I wouldn't reflexively recommend it for EILO, certainly.
Is there collaboration with other institutions to learn how to assess for EILO using your techniques? And I would add, is there resistance from anyone? Is it just a matter of disseminating the information, getting set up? What keeps it from being a standard of care?
That's a super question. So like the art of building a team is something that fascinates me, and it is not straightforward, right? Like if it were easy to get consensus, we would probably have that as a country on a lot of things beyond EILO. The big things that are coming out, we haven't had a real common language around it. And so, you know, the terms are changing, and they're sort of internationally, the term EILO is used actually quite a bit more than in the US, but it's changing a lot even in the past couple of years. We've collaborated, or myself as an individual, have actually spent more time collaborating in Europe than here. And so there's really great centers at a hospital called the Royal Brompton in London. There's a center at Bergen University in Western Norway. There's a great center. In Copenhagen, there's a hospital called Bispebjerg. And there's a lot of expertise there related to EILO, especially like in the sort of computer analysis of these images. There's a group in a little bit north of Stockholm at a university called Uppsala University that there's a lot of interest in this. In the U.S., it's picking up. I think COVID really sort of sidelined a lot of this work in the past year because it just wasn't the focus area. But I know there's groups sort of in Seattle, Boston that are starting to pick up with this. There, you know, there's a individual provider in Texas that's gaining an interest. It's just not quite as popular to work on as it is in Europe, for sure. So, but we'll get there. Like, the team building takes time. It's not like I give one lecture and everyone agrees. It's like, no. This is a labor of love over years and years.
It may be a difficult question to answer, but how often do you think asthma is misdiagnosed and is actually something else?
It probably depends on what specific group that you're talking about. When you're sent to see me specifically, clearly somebody's already like thought that, either the parent or the referring provider. So it's a really high percentage. I think that like historically at our institution, like across ages, there's sort of this rough number of like, maybe a quarter or a third have maybe not been totally misdiagnosed, but, you know, either misdiagnosed or there's something else going on that's contributing. Maybe it's allergies or, you know, something else, stomach acid, or there's another condition like EILO altogether answering the question. I think the big thing around that is asthma is a pretty, I wouldn't say exactly straightforward thing to treat. But there's $100 million of asthma research probably every year going on in this country. Like, the medicines work, the diagnostics work, the therapeutics work. So if you're doing what you think you need to do and you're not getting the result that you're expecting, I think it's always good to ask that question of, could there be something else going on, either contributing or just something else altogether?
So someone asked, the first 15 minutes of breathing during exercise is very laborious, then gets better. Is there a way to make those few first minutes earlier without a rest easier without a rescue inhaler?
Yeah, so that's a super question. And there's something sort of hidden in this question too. So it turns out that asthma is a condition that has something that we call a refractory period. And essentially what happens is if you were to have asthma you know, with or without a control or inhaler or rescue inhaler, and you take off running, about 5 minutes in, your lung function will drop off. And then it turns out that you can sort of push through it. Different molecules become produced that actually prevent the airways from constricting down further. So when somebody tells me, like, yeah, it's really weird, I go running and the first 15 minutes are brutal, and then 30, 45 minutes in, I'm doing great, to me, that's code for there's asthma. Like, the EILO people do not tell that story. It turns out that marathon runners of, like, the 60s, you know, before things like albuterol in inhalers were readily available, they'd actually go out and run 2-3 miles, take an hour or two off, and then go run the marathon, and they would perform a lot better, both from a respiratory perspective and from an overall performance perspective, than they would have if they were to just sort of cold turkey start at the finish line. I think the code for me behind this question is, I'd say I would probably think about modifying the asthma therapy a little bit, because it sounds like that's maybe what's going on.
So unfortunately, we have a lot of questions that deal with personal experience. So, and I'm afraid we're not going to get to them because time has run out. But I would ask if there's anything that you'd like to cover in summary as we call it a day.
Yeah, I mean, I think the biggest thing is, you know, I don't think anyone that works at National Jewish is in it to make like $20 million. Like, we're here to be a resource. And so if you want to, you know, pop a question in the email that I threw up before, I'm happy to do my best to get at it. I'll shoot straight with you if it's sort of outside of my area of expertise. I'll frequently forward it on to who I think is the right person. You know, at the end of the day, we're not allowed to give a lot of specific individual medical advice across state lines, but we're happy to try to point you in the right direction. You know, if you happen to be in Sweden, I can tell you who the people are in Sweden and Norway and Denmark and the UK. You know, but feel free to reach out to us and ask us about our program. You know, we've got a really great setup for people that are traveling in that's, you know, really encapsulated in a week. And I'm more than happy to meet with you for 5-10 minutes over Zoom and tell you a little bit about it. Otherwise, you know, if you've got questions or you think that you can contribute to the team, great. Or if you think we can contribute to your team, I'm happy to hear about those collaborations.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Olin. It's evident that the work you're doing is of tremendous value as an integral part of the National Jewish Health effort to combat respiratory and related diseases. We're grateful for your commitment and contribution. Would ask that you all consider supporting the work of Dr. Olin and all the other physician scientists at National Jewish, whose work continues to have a real impact on the health of millions around the world. Please tune in for a special Dialogue with a Doc program on April 8th, when three of our leading experts will give an update on COVID and the answers we continue to pursue. That will be followed on April 15th with a highly anticipated program on autoimmune diseases and the lung. And with that, and with thanks once again to Dr. Olin and Insmed for their support, we hope you stay well and stay safe. Thank you very much.